I'm Maureen Nader, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today, we have Kate Lieber with us. Kate, let's start off our list of questions. We have quite a few for you today. So tell us a little bit about your background and why are you running for Oregon Senate?
Yeah, thank you so much. And thank you to the League of Women Voters for doing this, because this is really valuable. You know, I was gay in Indiana in the 80s. And that really was profound for me, because I really had that feeling of powerlessness is what really grounds me in many of the issues that I'm passionate about today. The feeling led me to go to law school because I didn't want to feel that way anymore. And I wanted to help other people who were feeling powerless. So I went to law school. After I graduated, I joined the Multnomah County District Attorney's Office, and I concentrated on child abuse and domestic violence cases. And I was there for a good long time, about 13 years. After I left the DA's office, I got what I considered to be one of my battle scars, which I was diagnosed with breast cancer. And I was really young. It was really scary. But I knew that this was pivotal, and I saw our broken healthcare system up close and personal. And, you know, I realized no one should fight, be fighting for their lives while really they're fighting for fighting for bills to pay while they're fighting for their life. I also, after I kind of battled through that, I was appointed to the Psychiatric Security Review Board, which is the board that has jurisdiction over people in under a guilty except for insanity designation in the state. Again, it gave me a really interesting look into mental health and how the state deals with it. And again, extraordinarily impactful and concerning. After I rolled off that board that I was on for 8 years, I was interested in the intersection of mental health and homelessness and joined Transition Projects, which is a nonprofit that transitions 1,000 people a year out of homelessness into homes and runs many of the shelter beds. And again, so impactful to try to understand this unbelievably difficult problem. But really at my core, I'm a teacher. I've been a teacher at Portland Community College for years. I so enjoy it. And it's one of those things that has really led me, especially now, to have great empathy for our teachers that are going through this incredibly difficult time with the global pandemic. But how did I get here? Maureen, I consider myself an accidental politician. This was not my path that I thought I saw myself on. But, you know, when 2016 happened and Donald Trump happened, you know, I really realized that our state legislatures were, you know, they were the ones that were holding at bay and pushing back on all the things that the federal government and all the rights that they were taking away from us. But then in 2019, when the walkout happened over climate change in the Oregon legislature, I really felt like I needed to get into the game. You know, I've got a 16 and an 18-year-old, and one of the things that I wanted to make sure I did was, if I had an opportunity to make a difference, I needed to do that. And so I did. And so I'm here because I'm someone who is passionate about getting things done, is passionate about fighting for people's rights and those who are voiceless. And I really want to make sure, especially in these unprecedented times, that we've got somebody in the Oregon State Legislature who is really working for the working people.
Passing a balanced budget in light of the pandemic and the wildfires will be a very challenging task in this coming session. If elected, yeah, what will be your guiding principles as you make difficult budgetary choices?
Look, this is going to be a really, really tough session, right? I mean, We know that the economic toll that this pandemic and now, quite frankly, the wildfires have placed on the Oregon state budget is, again, unprecedented. It's going to be really important to lead with your values. And quite frankly, you know, one of the things that is so important to me is to make sure that our kids are taken care of. We need to make sure and protect education spending. We need to make sure that we protect our health care, because that is something that is incredibly important. And we need to make sure that we understand that putting money towards opening back up our schools and childcare when it's safe to do so is the thing that's going to help us with the economy. So it's going to unfortunately be about what we choose to cut less than it is going to be about what we choose to keep whole. But leading with our values, and our values have to be rooted in our future, and our future are the kids. So that's kind of how I'm thinking about how we can look at this really unfortunate budget that we're going to have to get through.
Following up on, you know, what you just talked about, what are your thoughts on the lack of childcare options for working parents and how that impacts our economic recovery?
Yeah, you know, the global pandemic and even these wildfires, you know, they are highlighting cracks that were in the system already. These cracks aren't new. We had childcare deserts in almost every single county in Oregon. So that alone was something even before this pandemic. We can't start our economy without thinking about childcare. Working people can't get back to work without good quality, adequate, safe, and affordable childcare. That was a path that we needed to be on before the global pandemic, and now it is a path that is absolutely critical. So we can't divorce our economic recovery from our childcare. It is actually they're part and parcel of the same thing. So until we put together a comprehensive childcare solution, I think our economy is going to continue to suffer. So I would suggest that we continue to look at those ways of making sure that we've got adequate childcare. I think that childcare is going to change as we look at the global pandemic and what it's doing to sort of these big, large childcare communities. And we need to make sure that working people can get back to work and they can know that their kids are safe to do so.
On another issue, on Oregon's suicide rate and incidents mm-hmm. of domestic violence have been sharply increasing during this pandemic, and gun purchases have skyrocketed. If elected, what legislative steps would you take to address, to encourage gun safety and prevent the escalation of gun violence?
Yeah, you know, this is actually really personal to me. First of all, I prosecuted domestic violence cases and I prosecuted child abuse cases. And we know that Oregon families are really suffering right now, and domestic violence and child abuse are up. And that's because there's sort of less eyes on people. So that is incredibly scary. In addition, I had a first cousin who actually killed herself with a gun pretty recently. And it was a suicide that we sort of didn't see coming. But it highlights the desperation that people feel right now. And it's really important that we take steps to have comprehensive background checks for gun owners, that we have, once gun owners have them, that they are storing them in safe places so that people can't get access to them, whether they're children or otherwise. And making sure, quite frankly, and I know this isn't sort of exactly what you asked me, but mental health is a piece of this if we're going to talk about suicide rates. And we have got to start looking at our mental health system. You know, Oregon spends way under, is one of the last in the country in spending on mental health. And after this global pandemic and after the devastating wildfires and after the economics, the terrible economic recovery that we're going to have to go through, I think one of the biggest things that we can do is really focus more on trying to figure out how can we support people's mental health. And that will translate. It's intersectional with education, with gun violence and suicide rates, with the criminal justice system, with homelessness. So I really believe that that's a part and parcel of an answer to this question.
Thank you. This 10 minutes goes so quickly. So we are here in our really wrap-up.
Okay.
So just as we finish this out real quickly, why should voters choose you? Why should they vote for you?
These are really uncertain times. It is really important I'm not going to tell anybody anything they don't know. People need to vote like their way of life depends on it, because it does. And I mean all up and down the ballot, right? We've got it from the president of the United States all the way down to down ballot races. And what we need is people who have a track record of getting things done, which I do. What we need is people who will roll up their sleeves and do the hard work. And it's going to be hard work. And I've got that track record. I have the track record of helping people who have felt their voicelessness, if that's a word. I really believe that given the stakes of this election, that I am the best person suited to represent Senate District 14. And I sincerely hope that people go to my website at katefororegon.com, learn more about me, and consider voting for me.
Well, Kate, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Yes, thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciate the League of Women Voters and what you have done for 100 years.
Great. And voters, don't forget to visit vote411.org for complete candidate and ballot information before you vote. Thank you.